And I'm never, never sickensy.
What, never?
No, never.
Thanks for listening to the Dunesteef Audio Fiction Magazine. And now here's your hosts, Big Anklevich and Rish Outfield.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of the Dunesteef Audio Fiction Magazine.
What, already?
Already. Can you believe it? It hasn't even been 6 months yet. I'm Big Anklevich.
And I'm Rish Outfield. And it could be 6 months, depending on how long it takes you to get me this recording.
How long it takes me to post it after you've edited it.
Oh, that too. It's a good point.
I'm sorry, everybody. So should
we just jump into this thing, or should we warn people? Should we set people up?
I think what we should do is you should run around behind them, and I'll distract them. I'll talk to them for a minute, and then you get down on your hands and knees right behind them, and then I'll push them, and they'll fall over your back. It'll be so funny.
Okay. I did see a girl become a quadriplegic that way, but best sex I ever had.
Oh, the cat's eaten it.
Has he?
So set us up for the fall.
Well, first off, if you haven't listened to the last episode, the most recent episode that was B-Story/Into the Furnace, you need to go do that. And we'll wait for you right here. You said that we're not in a hurry tonight.
No, we're fine. Yeah, I mean, you can go and listen to that whole episode while we sit here. As a matter of fact, you can also buy Rish's book that we talk about, Into the Furnace, and listen to all of that while we sit here. That's fine. I mean, we'll wait.
It's times like this that I'm grateful that Announcer Man is dead. But if you listened to the last episode, and it's been a long time, I guess we'll remind you what we did in that episode and what this episode is all about. Big made a mistake about 5 years back. And one of the results of that mistake, I don't know how to explain it.
Is a fear of bees.
Yeah, you...
Yeah, my 4-year-old son has this weird, kind of extreme fear of bees. I'm sure it's one of those things that'll pass in a while. But for now, anything that makes a buzzing sound freaks him the hell out. The other day, well... The story that this all comes from is, I was getting in the shower, I got in the shower, was taking a shower, my wife was trying to sleep because, you know, she's always doing the crappy really early in the morning shift, and so it's her one chance to sleep late, so she was doing that, and my son had woke up and gone downstairs, and while I was in the shower, all of a sudden he started screaming. I couldn't hear it. Because I had the water going in the shower, but it was apparently one of those, like, blood-curdling, you know, you think he's either broken a limb or severed a limb or a masked man with a large machete and, like, worms, you know, in place of his skin has just come in the door, something like that. And so my wife, who seconds before was completely asleep and snoring, is just like, I'm coming. And I heard her yelling this, and I was like, what's going on?
You'd never heard her yelled at before.
Yeah, I figured she was up taking care of it. So I finished my shower. And yeah, when I got out, I said, so what was going on out there? And my wife says, there was a bee. And yeah, apparently he'd heard a buzzing noise and immediately jumped to the conclusion that a bee was attacking him and was going to sting him very soon, and he needed to scream. Turns out it wasn't even a bee either. It was just a fly. It was just a house fly that was in the house. So that was the...
That was the story you told me.
Right. And you were just like, oh, it sounds like there should be, you know, a story in this. We should be able to turn this into at least a short story, if not a gigantic 10-part series of YA novels.
Okay.
So you kind of challenged me to come up with something. And... I thought about it for a minute or two.
If that.
And it made me think of, like, somebody who somehow is in control of bees. Like, this child has, like, a mutant ability. He's an X-Men or something. And he realizes that he can control these bees. Except for, you know, he's deathly afraid of bees. And, you know, where does the story go from there? I don't know, but it could be really interesting. And I really liked also the idea of it being about a very young child. But yeah, basically that's all I came up with for it. And then after that, we threw it out there. We said, dear listener, what do you think? Does this spark any creative juices in you or not? And it turns out apparently it did, at least for some people.
Yeah, I found that there was a silver lining to your worthlessness as a writer, in that there were a ton of people that jumped on it and said, oh, hey, here's my take. And some people went as far as to record their takes on your idea. It was a turnout way better than I expected there to be. In fact, if a third that many people had come to my birthday party the last time I had one, I would continue to have birthday parties and celebrate that day, but I don't. So this episode is going to be all about the bees, all about the bee stories.
Not the A stories, those are too good for our show, but we do...
Right, you send your A stories to the Escape Artists Network.
Right, but we do manage to get some B stories here, so that's cool.
I dig it. So I guess what we'll do is just, we're going to switch off back and forth reading these submissions, right? What?
That sounds good to me. Should we jump right into it? Does it matter which one goes first?
Well, let's do Not the Bees first.
Not the Bees!
Because I think that was the first one that we, well, oh, Nobilis was the first one that I got. But.
Not the Bees!
Okay, so our very first submission, and hopefully this is as entertaining for you guys as it is for me. But, you know, if not...
Sorry.
Yeah, it's not your show, is it? Okay, so... The first submission was Andrew Odell. And he even titled his... Not the Bees.
Oh, not the Bees.
My job is pretty tedious. When I'm at work, I go to lots of different locations in the area, pick up packages and bring them all back to the warehouse for sorting and storage. It takes most of my waking hours, and I don't get much sleep, so sometimes I'm running late in the morning. Today was no different than usual. I was in my little office getting route directions a coworker had sent me, when suddenly I heard a scream in the next room. I dashed in to see what was happening, to see one of the kids sitting in a small hexagonal fort made from furniture. She was screaming, "Bees! Bees everywhere! Not the bees!" over and over again, while shrieking. Her caretaker walked in and stared at the child mournfully with her bulbous eyes as she turned her head back and forth and shook her wings. "No change today, 9276? I asked her. "The same as every morning. I just don't understand it." She leaned over to me and flicked a fragment of dry leaf off of my abdomen. "Better finish grooming yourself and get to work, 12,038, she added. We brushed our antennae together and parted ways. Another busy day.
Not the bees!
No, not the bees! No! Killing me won't bring back your goddamn honey!
That was Andrew Odell.
That wasn't like a drabble. That wasn't just an idea. That was a actual story, right?
That was, and that wasn't the requirement, but I love that he did that. I think that that's really cool. What do you have?
I have something from a man named Sam.
Sam could be a woman.
Oh, I guess that's true.
Sorry. Or queen.
I have something from an androgynous person named Sam.
Oh, my eyes! My eyes!
Who I believe is the boyfriend/girlfriend of Pat. Or no, that was Chris. Sorry.
It was Chris.
Sam was the hot chick that dressed in biker jacket on Facts of Life. right? Or no, that was Joe. Jeez.
Sam, I think, was the one that had the mental. Anyway, sorry. Let's continue.
Okay. So, here's Sam's email. I had some really interesting characters come to mind with the superheroes afraid of their powers idea you talked about. That would be my first choice of stories I'd like to hear. A boy with a fear of insects, particularly bees, who can control insects. A girl who can fly, who had agoraphobia and won't leave her house. A girl with super strength, who is so afraid of breaking things or hurting people that she's gone catatonic. A super genius with such crippling OCD that he can't function in society, all members of a support group for heroes with disabilities. I was also imagining a kid in a post-apocalypse industrial wasteland who comes across a work drone with bee stenciled on the side, painted that yellow and black striped combination of construction vehicles and places, with a chassis and body that also served to remind the child of bees. The bees he knows are the killer bees that survived the end and are hyper-aggressive still. So his initial contact with the drone scares him to panic, making him hurt himself so badly that the drone has to use the inbuilt medic pack the drone still carries and has never used. The drone then stops to protect the wounded boy as he heals, awaiting proper authority and medical personnel to come and care for the boy. Meanwhile, the boy has to find a way to deal with his fear and come to grips with this unlikely caretaker. So that's interesting. I don't know why. Probably because recently I've seen the trailer to Pete's Dragon, but that makes me think of Pete's Dragon, like a sci-fi modern version of Pete's Dragon, where there's this drone thing left over in a post-apocalyptic world that becomes the friend of some little boy. That's kind of...
Or queen.
We are talking about bees here, after all. Yeah, I don't know. That strikes my fancy.
Hopefully you're enjoying this. I think it's cool that these people all had a take. The next one, I think, was actually the first one I received, and it was from Nobilis Reed, who has the Nobilis Erotica podcast.
Yes.
And
head
I believe
on over there and check it out.
That's the sound of people fleeing our podcast with all their might to go toward his. But he actually sent a recording, an audio version, and so let's listen to that together, huh?
Hey there, Rish and Big. This is Nobilis Reed, calling you, well, recording this from my car while I'm stuck in traffic, because that's where I listen to podcasts, and I wanted to get this down while I was still thinking about it, because, as you know, the human brain completely erases all thoughts upon exiting a car. I'm sure you've come across this effect, you know, where you go and you drive 30 miles to get to a place, and you arrive and you get out of the car, and you think, why am I here? What's going on? Who am I? What's
my
name?
This is not my beautiful wife.
Whose car is this? No, that's just me? Okay. Well, anyways, I had this thought while I was listening to your podcast about a premise for a story. So my thought was on a child suddenly for no reason becoming afraid of bees. Is something that is contagious, that is like teaching it or learning it from other kids at school or kids he plays with or what have you. And that this is a kind of a contagious phobia, because there's no, you can't point to a real trauma for it. It just kind of happens. And then in the course of the story, the child starts getting other strange ideas, things that can't be explained as easily as, oh, some other student got stung and they learned about it from somebody at school or a playmate or something like that, but rather they're learning other things like weird alien languages and mystic formulae or weird political systems, or just anything that's completely inappropriate to an elementary school student. And nobody can tell where the knowledge is coming from. And that would be something that would be, you know, I mean, a child suddenly becoming phobic of bees is a little traumatic and certainly not fun for the child or the parents, but ultimately not something that requires investigation or anything but just kind of like a moment of curiosity, except if you're the hosts of a podcast that don't have much else to talk about. So then it evolves into something more sinister or curious or awesome, even. I mean, it could be something awesome that happens. I mean, it depends on the tone of the story. But anyways, that was the thought that I had listening to the podcast. I hope you find this idea interesting.
I always have this distrust of children and the idea of a child saying things that he couldn't know or having knowledge or information well beyond their age or what, and that sort of thing. So of course, when he was describing that, it became ominous to me. It's like something is communicating with our children, something is plotting, using our children. Something is indoctrinating our children.
My child has come home as a communist.
But, you know, he said, yeah, that there's the opportunity for, or there's the option of, you know, maybe it's something awesome.
Which could be interesting. I mean, it could be interesting to have it seem as something really, really ominous at first. You know what I mean? Like something weird is going on. And then instead it turns out to be something completely transcendent and wonderful, and human beings take a step into the next, stage of evolution or something like that, and now we move on to be like that giant baby thing that was floating in space at the end of 2001.
I'm sorry, did you mention 2001? I nodded off there.
Something like that. I don't know, that could be an interesting way to go with that. Then you can have your cake and eat it too, because, you know, it's both ominous and cool. How the fear of bees works into evolving to the next level, I'm not sure. But I bet somebody who is talented could totally work that out.
Well, the idea that something is communicating, you know, not just with your child, but with all children, and then eventually that knowledge spreads beyond just children, is interesting to me. And then what purpose would a fear of bees achieve? And you know, what if there is an insectoid alien species or race or armada on its way to Earth right now? And this information, this unreasoning terror of insects, of bees, spreads across the whole planet, so that when they arrive, we're prepared or terrified of them, you know.
Yeah, it could be a weapon that they're sending forward, so that we're so terrified.
Oh, so that
of
we
them
quail
that
in
we
fear.
Can't
that, oh,
even act.
I hadn't thought of that. I thought that maybe there was a benevolent species of alien that was trying to help us out, that was preparing. It's like, you know,
you guys
bee,
need to be ready to fight these guys.
The bee aliens are just leaving their planet, and they're on their way to ours. And it's like, learn from our mistake, learn from our weaknesses. And but yeah, your thing is fine too, you know, that the insects are doing this themselves just so that, you know, we all drop into fetal position and defecate upon sight of these things.
Mm-hmm. That definitely sounds like an idea with potential. Okay, so this one was sent in by Andy Dillbeck. This seems to have no title, so I'm just going to call it Not the Bees!
No! My eyes!
A blood-curdling scream blasted me out of a deep sleep. I shot out of bed and into the wall. Swearing under my breath, I stumbled out the bedroom door and down the hall to the living room, where my 4-year-old was apparently being murdered. As I approached the room, I started to make out the words that she was shrieking. Bee! Bee! Get away! Save me! Not again. I slowed my stumbling rush and tried to calm my racing heart. My daughter, Sam, was cowering under the coffee table as a large black fly buzzed around the ceiling. Calm down, Sam. It's just a fly. It won't hurt you. She stopped shrieking, but her sobs weren't much better. I picked her up, carried her out of the room, and held her until her breathing was back under control. I looked at the clock, 7:45 on a Saturday morning. My one day to get to sleep in. Well, I wasn't going to try to go back to sleep now. It's okay, Sam. What do you want for breakfast? This bee phobia was a recent event, but it was getting old really, really fast. 3 weeks before, Sam had woken up from a nightmare and had been scared to death of bees and any other buzzing insect ever since. I had tried everything I could think of, and all the suggestions from people online. We started with trying to analyze the nightmare to see if it might have triggered the fear. Were there bees in your dream, Sam? I asked. I don't remember. I think there were some crawly things, had been her reply. We tried looking up bee facts online. You know, Sam, bees are good bugs. They make honey. And they only sting if they're scared. They don't want to sting you because they'll die if they do. Just ignore them and they'll ignore you. No amount of reasoning seemed to help. I just hoped she'd grow out of it before too long. It was a bright and sunny morning, and so I decided to take her to the park and get some energy out, in the hopes that she might take a nap later so I could too. Sam ran around the play structure. I pushed her on the swings for a while, and we had a good time. Then it was time to go. We walked back to the car. I buckled her into her seat, got in, rolled up the windows, and turned on the AC before pulling out of the parking area. We had traveled about a block when a scream from the back seat almost caused me to crash into the car in front of me. I looked in the mirror and saw a bee walking around on the side of the car seat. Apparently, it had flown into the car to check out something sticky on the side of the seat while we had been parked. I tried to calm Sam down while looking for a place to pull over, but she was incoherent with fear. I had just pulled into the school parking lot and put the car into park when it happened. The bee had gotten close to Sam's leg and she had flailed out at it, trying to drive it away. Instead, she hit it and it reacted by stinging her. The screams rose in volume and suddenly stopped. I threw the driver's door open and raced to open hers. She was in her car seat in an almost catatonic state, and then she started to convulse. I raced to unbuckle her while dialing emergency services at the same time. The operator answered as I was laying her out on the ground next to the car. The convulsion stopped. What is your emergency? My daughter was stung by a bee. She started convulsing and isn't moving. We're in the elementary school parking lot. An ambulance is on its way. Is she breathing? I checked and her chest was rising and falling. I checked her pulse. Yes, she's breathing. It doesn't sound like she's having trouble. Her pulse feels strong but fast. I paused for a second. There are little hive-like bumps forming around her neck and by her ears. They're getting pretty big. They're turning a dark color. Oh my God. In my ear, I could hear the operator asking me what was happening, but words wouldn't come. As I saw in horror what was going on, as each of the hives burst open, letting loose a mass of small black worms. They wiggled in the light for a moment before falling still in death. I was frozen, unable to breathe, when a thrill of hope. Sam's eyes fluttered open and she focused on my face. They're gone, Daddy. I can't hear them anymore. I'm not scared of bees anymore, Daddy. The sound of sirens came closer as I held her, and the dead worms on the pavement dried up and blew away. So that's the end.
That's the end?
That's the end. Yeah, that was an interesting story.
So these things had invaded his daughter somehow and had caused her to be afraid of bees because it would be fatal for them.
I think that...
Is that that's what you got as well?
Is, well, I didn't get it until you told me.
Wait, what were you thinking?
I have no effing idea, to tell you the truth. I didn't really get it. But now that you say that, I think, yes, that's exactly what I was thinking. I think that's probably what's going on here. At first, I just thought, you know, the bees had laid some kind of, you know, when they stung her or whatever, they laid some kind of thing in her, and then she was having a reaction. I don't know. That's what I thought of at first. At first, I think I thought she was turning into a bee, but that turned out to not be the case because a bunch of little black worms or whatever came out. What do you think they were? Some kind of alien beings that were just maybe not alien beings, but just some kind of weird parasites that do like the, what
like
is it?
Tapeworms kind of thing, right?
But there's like a... Or like the spiders, for example, that you hear stories like creepy urban legends or whatever
about.
They lay
eggs
where
in their
they,
necrotic tissue.
Yeah, they lay eggs in some person and the person gets like a big boil or something and they're like, "Hey, what is this boil?" And they one day it pops and all these live spiders come running out of it, like baby spiders. Everybody, I think, has at least heard that once in their life. Maybe that's a real thing.
I believe so. I think they said that's where Justin Bieber came from.
Oh, okay. That's understandable.
Thank you, Andy, for sending that in.
Yeah, that's very cool. A full-on story.
I've lost
much
track
more than,
of what we're talking about.
Yeah.
Because two weeks have passed
two
in
weeks
the
has
middle
passed.
Of recording.
Yeah. Yeah, sadly, I can't remember what I thought the first time around. So that was Andy Dillbeck's contribution to the blues. Ah!
What?
All right, so what do we got next, Mr. Rish Outfield?
We've got one from... he calls himself Aspiration Realized. I think his name is actually Cameron.
Realized?
Perspiration Realized is his real name.
Oh.
So,
Respiration Realized Ooh. Is his...
So here's what he sent. Initially, it was difficult for me to get a story out of this concept. Partially because a lot of solid ideas were mentioned as offhand examples, and I didn't want to repeat them. But this contest, or precursor of a contest, or whatever you want to call it, is important to motivating you guys again, and I've always wanted to submit something to the Dunesteef, so I pondered it some more. Despite my efforts to find an entirely original idea, my concept ended up being somewhat similar to Big's idea of a bee-based superpower. But I think I got there through different means. When I didn't really get anything new from the kid angle, I decided to approach the idea from the angle of the bees instead. There's stories in the news about how the global population of bees is gradually disappearing, and people aren't sure why. I've always found it fascinating, like a mystery, but with Mother Nature. How to involve the kid? Maybe he's causing the disappearance of the bees somehow. After being traumatized by them when he was young, perhaps being allergic and having a near-death experience, or a member of his family or a friend killed from being stung, etc. And here I immediately thought of Batman, how in many variations his fear of bats led to his persona. It was very easy to imagine a supervillain in a bee costume who was somehow phasing bees out of existence, but I felt that could only work as a superhero parody, which, while fun, has a less serious feel than I was going for. Instead of having him dress as a bee and risking a rip-off of the Monarch from the Venture Brothers, I tried to think of how someone could actually go about causing the extinction of bees in a somewhat realistic way. It would require the kid to have an obsessive fascination with the bees, perhaps becoming the foremost expert on them. This could work to his advantage as he could use his position as an authority to throw people off the true causes of the problem. He would have to be very smart, and probably a narcissist or sociopath to boot for this to be believable. Dang it. For this to be believable. Of course, I would have to do a lot more research to flesh this idea out, but I do know that bees communicate through the way they move, as well as pheromones. So perhaps these could be used to bring about their undoing. Perhaps he somehow cultivates slash genetically engineers his own subspecies of bees that are capable of infiltrating established hives and somehow throwing them off through miscommunication of crucial processes in the upkeep of the hive. Some very unpolished ideas I had were having the beehive fail to react to danger, or fail to appoint a new queen, and steadily die off without a new generation of bees. Perhaps his sabotage bees somehow take over the position of the queen in a healthy hive, killing off the real queen and then steering the colony into disaster. I hope you guys go forward with a new contest at the Dunesteef. And I would like to see a Kickstarter or Patreon related to the podcast in some way. In a perfect world, you guys would start a Patreon based on the Dunesteef Audio Fiction magazine and acquire enough monthly donations that you could do the podcast full time. It would still be work, but it would be work you were getting compensated for, instead of only creatively fulfilling, as it is now. If that happened, I wouldn't be surprised if you guys could go full cast all the time again, and even go back to weekly or bi-weekly episodes regularly. But maybe that's thinking a little too wishful, and an anthology based on a broken mirror contest would be far more realistic slash approachable. Can't blame me for dreaming, though.
We can't blame you for dreaming. I've done some of that myself. That definitely is a perfect world example where we get enough that we could quit our jobs to do so. I wonder how long you'd have to go getting enough to live on before you feel safe enough, like, okay, this is going to keep up. I can quit now. Or if you're just like 1 month, you're like, hey, I can live on this. I'm quitting. And then the next month, you're, oh, damn, I shouldn't have quit that job I had for 12 years because now it's been filled by someone else and I'm out of luck.
Yeah, see, that seems much more realistic, that part.
That's the real world, not the perfect
world.
Have we
ever seriously talked about if this show took off, whether we would quit our jobs and just be podcasters? I know there are people that's what they are. Just like there are people that are YouTube personalities and they somehow make $100,000 a year or a week in that one woman that likes to talk about the problems of men's case. But to go back to what Cameron's idea was. That was a big deal in the news just recently about the mysterious death of all these bees.
Yes, colony collapse disorder is what they call it. It's something that totally freaks me out, like, big time. It's been going on for years now, and I actually have more than one brother who is a beekeeper, and I think even one of them has experienced that, where he went out and all his bees were dead one day. And I think he had more than one hive, though, so, you know, one of them was dead, the other one's still going, so at least there was that. But yeah, it's a weird thing. And it really freaks me out, just, you know, the idea of what would happen to this world if suddenly there were no bees. Because bees are like the major pollinator, I guess. And the amount of plants that need pollination is really large. I don't know if, do wasps and other, you know, butterflies and all that crap that also land on flowers, would they be able to pick up the slack? Would they fill in the gap?
Well, would they know to? Would they care to? You've never seen a wasp or a butterfly with a shitload of pollen on its legs like you do a bee, where they just pack it on. And it's their job. And they, you know what I mean? They take it from flower to flower and just like, wow, they really know what they're doing.
Yeah, I don't know. I've been around plants that are swarming with not bees, but the kind of things, wasps, they'll sting ye because they want to.
They're the skinheads of the insect world.
Yeah. I mean, I've been around trees that are, you know, that are flowering and that are just swarming with stuff, and you look at them, you're like, oh, I'm not even gonna walk near that tree, because those aren't just bees, those are something else. Because bees, you know, they got the whole deal where they'll rip out their innards if they sting you, so they're not just going to do it just because. I wonder if that makes, like, a wasp a more highly evolved version of a bee or something like that, you know? They evolved past that rejected trait, that trait that kills you, It's like, yeah, you got a stinger, but you know, you use it and you die, so kind of fucking completely useless.
But what's, and I know this is way, this is a stupid, deep question, but what use is a wasp? You know what I mean? Okay. Bees in nature serve the purpose of, yes, pollinating flowers. They also make honey.
I believe wasps land on flowers and stuff like that too.
And they pollinate, or they're just dicking around?
I think they feed off, you know, I think they feed off the nectar of the flowers or something like that. I mean, I don't think bees are pollinating. They're lured there by the flowers, basically, you know, to the flowers basically like, hey, look, here's some food, come get it. And I'm going to trick you into doing something for me while you're at it. Is kind of the way the stuff works. I don't know if you've ever seen, there's some flower, and it's this insane thing, like the design of the flower, the shape of it. It's got this like big petal or something, or stamen or whatever the hell it's called, that's sticking up off of it, so that when a bee comes down and lands on it and gets into it, it like leans over from the pressure of the bee, the petal moves down and touches the bee's back and deposits the seed or the whatever it is that the bee needs to take to the next plant on there. It's like this, you know, completely devious kind of thing where it's like, you know, the it clown with his little sign saying, look, free candy in this right here in the sewer. And he's down there saying, come on, we all float down here. And the kids are like, oh, okay.
You'll float too, yeah.
And they go down there. And yeah, and then, you know, it's just this tricky thing that it gets the bees to do. But anyways, we're getting off the subject here. But yeah, I mean, that whole thing of bees going away freaks me out. Because if we lose all the pollinators, then we lose so much of our food supply. And even if there's still plants around, I think what happens is you lose everything that adds variety to your diet, basically. You're stuck with, like, all the bland stuff is what's left. You can have beans and potatoes, and that's it.
Rutabaga!
Yeah. So, I mean, you wind up with just the most bland stuff left. All the fruits are gone. All the, I don't know, spicy stuff and all that kind of stuff. All berries and et cetera goes away. And, God, is that a world worth living in? Well, and is there anything that people can do to fix that? Can you, I don't know, will we suddenly be creating drone bees that fly around and just until they run out of gas and then they drop dead and there's just some government factory somewhere just producing an endless amount of them so that we can still have plants? I don't know. It's a creepy future. It's a scary future. Yeah, you started to say something. Sorry,
no, ahead. Just, but, like, it's a really childlike idea of this bee stung me or this bee stung my cousin. I wish there were no more bees. I wish they would all die or whatever, you know. And then it comes true, and it completely just Fs up the environment and our whole, the balance of nature gets tipped.
Yeah. This guy works at it, though. He's not even just...
That's true. He does.
It's not
just
even
saying,
just, I wish there were no more bees. I can see that being a thing, a childish thing, you know? Like some kid throwing a tantrum makes a wish and there's a genie that happens to make it come true or something like that. And it's a be careful what you wish for kind of a story. But this one is like a guy who dedicates his life to destroying bees and he wears a bee costume. Wait, no, that was X'd out. But he does call himself the Bug-Eyed Bandit.
Hey! Come on, man. I hope you would never bring that up again.
That was mixed. Sorry, I forgot about that, too.
But the,
what is the Venture Brothers thing? I'm not familiar with that. Are you?
Yeah, it's a cartoon. It's an Adult Swim Cartoon Network show, and the nemesis of the Venture Brothers is this character called the Monarch! And he dresses as a butterfly, and he has just this whole army of... What do you call it? Lackeys that'll...
Henchmen?
Henchmen. He's got all these henchmen, and they also dress like butterflies. Yeah, as I watched the show, I found myself liking the Monarch more and more and more. And he's just a really inept supervillain. One of those that just... If somebody just complimented him the right way,
you know, then he wouldn't be a bad guy.
So I just said they liked his story, he would cry and be done.
Stop it.
Oh, sorry.
That's me you're talking about. Yeah, the Venture Brothers, it's sort of a parody of Johnny Quest, but there's all sorts of other stuff going on in there, parodies. There's a Fantastic Four parody that's continuous, and his next-door neighbor is very obviously Doctor Strange from Marvel Comics. But, you know, because it's a parody, they can get away with that stuff. And...
parody of Johnny Quest, huh?
Yeah, because, you know, it's this family
that go on these... I remember Johnny Quest so little now that I don't know that I could... So the Quest family would go out and do stuff, and Johnny was just, like, the youngest. I remember he was kid, very blonde.
Yeah. And the Venture Brothers are two brothers... and their father is an adventurer, explorer, or whatever. And
Adventurer is out there!
It's a parody show. It's very funny, and apparently if you stick with it, it's one of those shows that rewards you for coming back. You know,
it's like Community?
That's what I was trying not to say. But yes, it's like Community. The more you watch it, the more jokes you'll get, and more... The writing becomes brilliant. It's like, let me say, it's like Arrested Development.
Okay.
I just pushed up my imaginary glasses. So it just sounds smart.
No, not the beast! Not the beast!
Yeah, that's an interesting idea, I think. It does seem like he says he wants it to be a serious story. So he doesn't want to go the route of the monarch and have a guy dressed in a bee costume who wants to... destroy all bees. But it seems like a motivation like that is kind of a cartoony or childish motivation.
Well, it does, yeah. You said that this guy is the expert on bees, the foremost world expert on bees. So it seems like you'd either gain a respect or appreciation for the bees, or you'd have to figure out some way to compensate for the loss of bees, because surely destroying them all would be bad.
Yeah, surely the world's foremost expert on bees is not going to be like, yeah, the world would be so much better off without them.
But I guess logic doesn't enter into it when you're obsessed with something, when you're super fixated on something like this character is.
That could be true.
And so, you know, other people could say, hey, well, but what would happen if this were released into the atmosphere, Doctor? I mean, it could kill every bee within a 10-mile radius. And he's like, 30-mile radius, Johnny. He said, well, yeah, what would happen then? He's, have you ever considered that? He's like, of course I've considered it. Okay, again, it sounds like I'm doing a parody character.
Mine is an evil laugh.
I don't know. A cartoon-related bee thing that wasn't funny. And we brought this up before, but on Spider-Man and His Amazing Friends.
Oh, yeah.
And I think it's the thing you most remember about Spider-Man.
Oh, yeah. It's almost the only thing I remember from Spider-Man and His Amazing Friends. Until I came on Netflix for a while and I actually rewatched some episodes. And then I was like, oh, okay. I remember a little bit more. I mean, I did remember, like, okay, Spider-Man and Firestar and Iceman were the three main characters. But that was pretty much it.
Well, there's Miss Lion, too.
Miss Lion?
Yeah, that was Aunt May's dog.
Okay, that wasn't like another superhero that was like brought in season 2 or something.
No. No, but there was a villain on one episode, as far as I know, of Spider-Man and His Amazing Friends, and it was called Swarm.
Swarm, Swarm, Swarm.
And for some reason, as a little boy, I was really freaked out by Swarm.
Yeah, me too.
It was just a huge... I think it was a human being... but it might not have been. It might have been a sentient swarm of bees in a, like a humanoid shape. But it would go, swarm, swarm.
Yeah.
And it had like this reverberating way of talking. And I don't know what, but it was scary as F for
a little boy. And it would zap people and they would turn into like bee people.
You're kidding me.
No, I'm serious.
They turned into bee...
Like, they would turn into bee drones that would attack Spider-Man, and he would have to fight. I actually rewatched this episode. I didn't remember that much. All I remembered was Swarm was, like a swarm of bees in the shape of a person that would fly around and go, swarm, swarm, swarm. And it would do that weird talking thing that we just did, you know? It was just swarm, swarm, swarm.
Well, see, you're making it sound, pardon my French, but really, really stupid. Was it?
When you look back on any cartoon...
Well, sorry, let me interrupt.
Your kid shit his fudging pants when he was 11 years old watching The Cat in the Hat, this green thing from a box. And you told the story 100 times, and every time you tell the story, he's a year older. and that's just stupid. But Swarm, in my mind, was legitimately scary. And now that you've seen it as an old man, was it legitimately scary, or is it stupid like you just described it?
Well, where is the stupid part? Is it the
swab,
weird way
swab,
of his...
Swab, swab, like, that's it, like it a wasn't... fucking Smurf language or something. I smurfed the Smurf out
no,
of
it.
Look
it
at
was,
the size of those
it
Smurfs!
It was like the weird, echoey, kind of reverberation thing of his voice that I'm talking about. It wasn't like cheesy Smurfy, I Smurfed it and then ran down the street where I Smurfed on the Smurf thing. It was, I would say, as far as that goes, that is legitimately scary.
Okay,
I mean, obviously,
it's a 30-something-year-old memory.
It's a really old cartoon, and it's not going to hold up. It's just impossible for something that you saw when you were 7 or 8 or something like that to hold up when you're 40. It just doesn't do it. Now, we're not 40. We're still a long way from getting to be that.
Well, I'm flying cars when I'm 40.
At least there's that.
I'm a woman in the White House, Billy.
But anyway, it doesn't hold up like it used to, and my kids couldn't sit through it.
Oh, because... you didn't look over and your kid filling his pants with all of his might. You're like,
no,
wow.
he was doing that, but had nothing to do with the show.
Like,
unfortunately.
Sure. And now I'm late for Driver's Ed.
Yeah, with all of his might. Grunting and freaking putting all his effort into it. I don't know. It was kind of, I mean, it was like they are when you see it years later. Like the plot, you're like, oh, really? That was what it was? Oh, that's kind of silly. I can't remember exactly how it went even now, because I mean, we watched it a year ago and I didn't pay close. When I saw that, I was like, okay, you guys got to watch this one episode. I don't care about it. Everybody sit down. Sit the down. And they watched it for a little while, but pretty soon they were just like, is he still looking? Can I go?
I've got to go change my pants.
Get out of
Will
here.
He notice?
He's not watching, right? Okay, I'm out of here. Go, go, go. Everybody run. It's like when I was when I was a teenager and I decided, I don't know why I decided this, because it was a really stupid idea, but I'd drawn this comic book, and this comic book was all about me and my friends having an adventure, and it was filled to the brim with stupid inside jokes, and it made no sense really at all. It was one of those just dumb things you do as a teenager. But I got this idea that this was the thing. This was like the test. The only example that can come to mind is on Real Genius, when the woman says you have to be able to hammer a 6-inch spike through a 2x4 with your penis to be worthy of her. But I swear there's... Okay, we'll go to the movie The Singles, where the girl... You know, she has this big, huge list of things that a guy has to live up to. And the guy says, wow, that's a tall order. And she's like, yeah, I know. Kind of pared it back. Now I just want somebody who says gazoon tight when I sneeze. So that's the thing. And then in the end, when Matt Dillon says gazoon tight, or actually says bless you, God bless you. And she's like, oh, and she loves him and kisses him. And they get together. You know, it was going to be my thing that I was going to judge women by. If they liked this stupid comic book, then that meant that they were the one. And so the first girl that I ever kissed came over to my house, and I decided I was going to show her this comic book. This is before I'd even kissed her. And she's looking at it, and finally, you know, she's like kind of glancing up like, how much of this shit does he want me to read before I can put it down? I could tell that was what she was thinking. She's like, okay, I've read like 5 pages of this. That's got to be enough, right? Because I don't understand what the hell is going on. This is terrible. So instead, we made out. Which was nice. Where was I going with this?
I don't know. You lost me, and now you got me back.
I totally lost.
You drew this comic book.
What my point was to...
Well,
it was
to be
about
related
this
to
being,
Swarm in some way.
It was about this being... Oh, maybe that was it. The whole how long am I going to have to bear this? That was what my kids were like, where they're just like, how long do I have to watch this stupid swarm show before I can just leave?
But see,
how long before
they know,
Dad will not yell at me?
Now they know how you feel when you have to go to the stupid school play or the stupid, okay, this is what we've learned in this year's course. And it's like, okay, this is the graduation ceremony from fourth grade to fifth grade. Okay, oh, hey, this is the school patriotic song thing. Oh, it's the Christmas thing. It's a Thanksgiving show and honor roll show. It's the science show. It's okay, now the myriad sports that you have to go watch your kids play poorly.
Yeah, I guess they do. But yeah, Swarm was a scary villain.
Oh, Lord, have we been talking about Swarm for 20 minutes because I made the mistake of mentioning it?
And, yeah, he was...
I blame you, Cameron. You. Not me.
He was pretty cool. I don't know if this villain that he's talking about could be Swarm-like in some way that would make him scary, make him, I don't know, realistically scary, not, you know... Because, like we were saying, he does sound more like a cartoon villain. Swarm was from a cartoon, but he was realistically scary. So, what do you got to do to this guy who wants to get rid of all the bees to make him realistically scary? I don't know. I mean, killing off bees is a bad thing. So there's that.
Somebody's doing it. It's not a story anymore.
That's right. We need to track this guy down. Cameron probably knows who he is, or is that man...
Hmm. And now we've said your name on the air. Get him, boys!
Okay, so that was Cameron's contribution to the blues.
Let's do Bria Burton.
Okay, yeah, Bria Burton sent us an audio recording that we could play.
Did you know that Bria is a real writer?
I did not know that. Tell me more.
No, it's just that is what we call a non sequitur. Drink it.
He's good.
I heard her on a radio show.
Wow.
Where they were interviewing authors about their books, and she had done signings, and she talked about the Damn Journey Into podcast.
Oh.
she also talked about the Drabblecast.
Oh, okay. Well, at least, wait a minute.
She talked about us too, but still. Boy, she had some nice things to say about the Journey Into podcast, which I think is the first time that has ever been done.
So that's good. That's nice for Marshall.
Sorry, Bria sent us in a reading. Sorry. I don't know why I mentioned the
She
thing.
Sent us a reading? You mean an audio recording.
Why? Did she not write a story and read it for us?
No.
Oh, okay. Well, play. Let me hear what she has to say.
Okay.
Bria here, really enjoying the talk about bee story and the ideas. I'm pretty scared of bees, so I'm looking forward to the story and the sound effects that I'm sure will make me cringe. Just the buzzing in the ear is terrifying, so do with that what you will, Dunesteef. I don't have a lot to add because big story actually sounds really interesting with the kid who's afraid but has control over this bee swarm. I just think you need to have at least maybe one of the bees kind of is immune to his control, like the rest of the swarm is doing their thing. So maybe this one bee is like the smarmy bee. So he is, you know, kind of getting into this connection with this one bee that doesn't quite follow the swarm the kid is controlling. But he could kind of end up being like Jiminy Cricket for the kid. Somehow. Anyway, that is my idea, and I don't know if it can go anywhere, but I just thought with that you could call it the Smarmy Swarm.
So there's one bee that he can't control, and that's the Jiminy Cricket one, or is it just...
Yeah, I think he doesn't control it, and this bee, like, tells him...
Right from wrong, or...
Yeah.
Does he... Tell him to always let your conscience be your
Yeah,
guide.
He says for him to be... Yeah, he says, you don't want to go to Pleasure Island with Honest John. And he totally ignores him, of course, and gets turned into a donkey.
So, sorry to interrupt. That is a legitimately scary scene.
Yeah, when they turn into donkeys.
Oh my gosh, dude.
Yeah, it's freaky. It's worse than like Night on Bald Mountain on Fantasia
and
stuff.
Yeah, it is so scary. Now, I haven't seen that in 30 years either. That scene, but it's
so
I remember
so it's
just because the kid is the boy that, I mean, they are
it's not a pleasant transformation. They are terrified, and they're like gathered up and taken by thugs and stuff like that, you know.
Yeah, these, and sold to and, farmers.
But
to
like, there's
carts.
The one that's like grasping at Pinocchio, trying to get help, and his hands turn into hooves. And oh my gosh, it's a scary.
Yeah, that was really scene. Freaky. And yeah, Jiminy Cricket. It's interesting because the story that Bria's taught, like my story, the idea that I had from my story, and I don't know, maybe it's the same thing as Cameron's idea where he's like, I want it to be serious, and we're like, sounds like a cartoon.
Sorry.
Maybe my idea is the same way, because that's what I was thinking. I was like, it's about a kid, but the kid is, he's got this power that he can control bees, but he's scared to death of bees, and so he's freaking out, and it's a really, I don't know, fear-filled story idea to me, but maybe to her, that's not what she's getting it from it, and it's, because her thing, we added Jiminy Cricket bee, then this is like bees that talk.
Grillo parlante.
Il grillo parlante.
Is it grillo or grillo?
I have no idea.
All right.
I would say griot probably, but that's because we got Spanish.
Yeah, Spanish always kicks in the door.
Fused in our culture, and I think Italian does not have the same rules, so it probably is an L sound.
Sorry, when we recorded this episode the first time, I asked Big about Claudio Carlotti, who wrote? Carlo Carlotti wrote, I asked him about the original book of Pinocchio.
Pinocchio.
And I asked him, was Jiminy Cricket invented by Disney, while Disney in 41, or was that always in the
part
book?
Of the book.
And there was a talking cricket called...
That was called...
Il Grillo Parlante.
Also translated
again,
to...
Sorry, it's not Spanish. It's not El Grillo. It's Il Grillo.
Grillo Parlante.
There you go. Thank you, amico. But yeah, Disney changed the name to Jiminy Cricket, and you speculated that Jiminy Cricket was already a something that people would say, like, gee whiz, you know, in place of something, I guess, that people found offensive.
Right. It
replaced Judas Priest.
It's one of those swear words that you use in place
boys
of,
to men!
Place of the like... other guy with similar initials. So yeah, I think that was already a thing, and they're like, oh yeah, we can use that as the name of the cricket.
Which is brilliant, actually.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's... Thank you, Bria. I'm sorry that almost everything we said about your story is in the outtakes now, but you've got a lovely voice, and you're a real writer, unlike one of us, and thank you for sending that in, and thanks for recording it. I dig that. Before I lost all... pleasure in the Dunesteef because of having to do this over.
Having
I was
to listen
so...
to that story a second time.
It was draining. I wondered how much of the story I had to listen to before I could just get up and go. It's just that was the whole
just
time.
Looking at your watch.
It's like, well, I'm sure
before
here for
you'll be
6
offended.
Minutes.
Oh, Charlie McCarthy and Edgar Bergen. Okay. Jiminy Cricket has been in other things, though. I swear he has.
I know.
They did all that wonderful World of Disney stuff.
Yes,
and they
that
would,
stuff.
Jiminy Cricket
anything
sings...
Anything educational.
I'm no fool, no siree. I'm going to live to be 103 from,
did
like, Mickey
I'm,
Mouse Club.
I'm bringing sexy back. Was that
I mean? Think he did that, too. Yeah. No, wait. That was those penguins. The baby
dance.
Penguins was the ones that did that. No, but he sings a line in the Mickey Mouse Club theme song, too. Like, hey there, hi there, ho there, you're as welcome as can be.
That was Jiminy Cricket?
Yeah. And then Donald Duck just says, Donald Duck!
Yes, I do remember. I always liked that Donald Duck.
Yeah.
And Donald Duck in Mickey's Christmas Carol, I believe, played Ed Gein. Anyhow.
Ed Gein?
Okay, well, give me a Jeffrey Dahmer. How's that? Thank you, Bria. Please, let us move on to something else. I think our friend Gino Moretto. What is his name?
Gino Moretto. Gino Moretto, il grillo parlante.
He could pronounce that correctly. He would not turn two L's into a yeah sound.
Yeah, probably not.
He's a good guy. But he's actually Irish, unlike the accent that we imagine that he has. But he recorded his comments, so we can actually hear him talk about probably soccer, knowing that he's not American. But here we go.
I don't
know
that Kiwis are that into soccer. It would be
everyone
rugby.
Is.
It would be rugby. He'd talk about the All Blacks.
Hey, come on, man. After I bring up Uncle Remus and...
Stop it. You're making weird noises.
I did not mean to.
Don't you push me?
Gino's B story. Okay, so there's a kid. Let's call him Jake. And Jake is about 8 or 9 years old. He's pretty young. Maybe as old as 10. Anyway, one night, completely out of the blue, he awakens from a terrible nightmare. He's never had a nightmare this bad before in his life. Nothing even approaching it. It's utterly terrifying. He's in a forest. He is running. It's at night. The forest is on fire. It's engulfed in flames. And all around him are swarms of frenzied, furious bees. And they're chasing him through the forest. And Jake is just running in terror. All he can do is run. Eventually, he trips over a log. And as he's struggling to get up, the bees are on him, stinging him over and over and over again. And he wakes up screaming from his nightmare. He finds that he's so terrified, he can't even face the idea of getting out of the house. He can barely leave his room. Weirdly, he finds that his very strict, no-nonsense parents, particularly his dad, are strangely understanding when he tells them that he's too terrified to leave the house. They call Jake's school and let them know that he won't be there for the rest of the week. And that's a whole 3 days. And the only other time Jake's ever had time off was when he got the mumps. Yeah, he's kind of puzzled by that, but he's not questioning it too much. So over the next few days, he gets a card from his classmates and his teacher, all wishing him well and a speedy recovery, which is another thing he didn't really expect at his school. He's a little bit of an outsider. He doesn't have that many friends. He's not popular. His favorite uncle turns up out of the blue, and that's also kind of a little bit surprising since he lives out of state. But his uncle says he was passing through on business, so that's a nice surprise for Jake. Even a girl from his school drops by that Jake sort of has a crush on to wish him a speedy recovery. He still has those dreams haunting him every night, though. Well, not every night. One night, he blissfully doesn't dream of the forest fire and the bees at all. By Sunday, he's able, since he's had some time to rest and recuperate, he finds he's able to go outside without going into a panic attack. He goes to church with his parents, and he's really scared. Everyone's got to know what the deal is with him, and he's afraid of people staring at him and whispering about him and generally acting like he's crazy. But nobody does. Even the priest, who normally Jake thought was quite a cold and imposing figure, takes him aside and offers his support to him, saying that whenever he needs someone to talk to, he's always there if Jake needs him. Jake's really uneasy about going back to school on the Monday following, fearing the inevitable name-calling, teasing, and probable bullying that will happen. Only none of that does. No one mentions a thing about it unless Jake brings it up first, and even then, when he does, everyone that he talks to about it is just supportive and unrelentingly kind and understanding. Even the normal small torments that he was subjected to during your average school day seem to have stopped. As he's leaving that first day back, he sees a bee. As he's going outside the school doors, he freezes. He finds he can't move until it's flown away. His next day at school, the counselor calls Jake in. Apparently Jake's parents have been in touch, filled him in with what's happened, and the council would like to run through some approaches of how to deal with that kind of fear and try and help Jake get over his fear of bees. He does this kind of guided meditation thing, which brings Jake in kind of almost a semi-dream state into the forest of his dreams. But now it's not nighttime, it's daytime, and the forest isn't on fire, although it's still kind of charred and skeletal, and no sign of bees. As Jake is wandering around in this meditative state, he feels that time seems to stretch out far longer than the therapy session should allow. Over the next couple of weeks, Jake has more and more time with the counselor, running therapy sessions for him. And the counselor early on tells Jake that he knows some other people, some other colleagues of hers, that will probably be able to help, and she'd like to bring them in and see if they can assist, if that's okay with Jake. Jake's a little uneasy about that, but he does agree. So as Jake continues these therapy sessions with the counselor and her colleagues, exploring all these different ways to kind of counter and work through his fear, Jake is wondering why the school seems to be spending so much time and expense on him. He's never heard of anything like this going on before. It's not like he's an incredible sports person, or he's a top academic student, or even being involved in a school production. He's just this normal kid. But yet, as he goes through this process, he finds the nightmares become less frequent and less intense. And they keep revisiting this guided meditation technique that the counselor started off with. And every time he goes in, the forest seems more and more rejuvenated. There's more greenery. The trees slowly seem to be coming back to a lifelike state. As the final part of the therapy, the counselor takes Jake away on a trip to the state park, the closest kind of forest area, which, again, is a couple of hours away. When they're there, and as they're walking through the park, Jake slowly realizes that they're walking through the forest of his dreams. And about the time he realizes that, the counselor stops before a reasonably large tree that has a bee's nest inside of it. There's a big hollow in the front, and bees lazily drift to and from the hole in its trunk, and Jake can almost feel the low buzzing sound from inside it. And he feels that fear start to well up in him again. And the counselor says that if Jake is able to approach the tree and lay his hand on it, then he'll be over his fear. Not that she's forcing him to or saying that he has to, just saying that if he were able to do that, that would be a sign of his healing. A part of Jake wants nothing more than to set that tree on fire and to have every bee inside it burn. But a larger part of him wants to be free of his fear. He slowly approaches and manages to lay a hand on the trunk. A bee lands on the back of his hand as he does so, and Jake finds that he's okay with that, that he doesn't panic and he's not afraid anymore. And it's at that time everything goes white. Jake wakes up. He's not a kid. He's a grown man. He's not in a forest. He's in some kind of hospital. Only things look way more advanced than the hospitals he knew. In fact, he seems to be inside of some small circular chamber lying down, almost like he's in a having a CAT scan or in an MRI tube. He hears this gentle female voice, the voice of his school counselor, telling him to relax and that everything will be all right. And as Jake is lying there, he starts to remember what happened. Jake was a soldier in the Colonial Army. Man has been able to move on from Earth and colonize other worlds. And he was defending an outpost. He was fighting a war against an insectoid race of invaders. They look vaguely like bees with their armor on and such. It was after a particularly brutal defense of a forest colony where most of his company had been slaughtered by these bee things that Jake had this incident. And he discovers that what had happened was he had gone into a post-traumatic induced kind of shock, entered a catatonic state, and mentally he had regressed to childhood in order to escape these kind of horrific experiences that he had gone through. What seemed like 2 weeks to him had actually been closer to maybe 6 months when he'd been inside this mental reconditioning chamber where a medical AI had been administering therapy to him almost continually. He is now cured. I think the story could end two ways, depending on whether you wanted a happy ending or a more downbeat ending. Either the war is over in that time, in that 6 months or a year or however long he's been in that chamber, Matrix style, with the AI guiding his dreams almost, or his mental state, and helping cure him. The war is over. The enemies have been defeated. The insectoid race has been driven off or whatever, and things look okay. Or the war is still raging. And now that Jake is able to face his fear of these creatures, he is able to return to the front and carry on the fight. But anyway, that was the idea I thought of. Thanks very much for letting me share it with you guys and with the Dunesteef audience at large. Hopefully you enjoyed it. Bye.
All right. Well, thank you, Gino, for sending that in.
Yeah, that was pretty impressive.
Director of the fantastic Lord of the Rings trilogy.
Yeah.
And then not quite as fantastic Hobbit movies, but still, you know.
But still a credit to his entire nation.
Agreed.
Is Gino's a real writer too then, like Bria? Because he sure seemed like it, didn't he? I think he's actually just like a teacher.
He's a school teacher, yeah.
Yeah, but he should be a real writer.
Yeah, the funny thing is he always emails me from the future. So it'll be like Sunday afternoon or Sunday night, and he'll be like, hey, I'm in, again, they've got the Liverpool accent, I'm in school, teaching my students at school, and all you need is love, and I want to hold your hand. And he sends that to me, and I'm just like, weird. It's from the future. Just give me just one sports score, just one, you know. Any
the All Blacks beat... I'm sorry, I wasn't supposed to get into the racism thing again.
That's not right. You know, I prefer to think of them as not at all white.
That was pretty cool. He went all out on that thing, too. He had, like, music in the background and stuff. Pretty impressive. I'm surprised he didn't go full cast and, like, have his kids do the lines of the little boy, although I don't think he did.
He's
any
kicking
actual,
himself for not doing
didn't
it.
Didn't do any actual lines, so maybe that's why. But yeah, that was a good stuff. That was a really interesting idea. It's interesting. You gave us two options for how it ends. You know, the war's over or the war's not over. And yeah, get back to the front, as they say in the Metallica song. I was thinking of a different ending where, and this is where I thought it was going to go. You know, he wakes up and he hears the disembodied voice and all that kind of stuff. And then when he finally steps out into the hall or whatever, the building is all occupied by these insectoid aliens, and the war is over, yes, but humans didn't win. They're, you know, enslaved, or they're, you know, I don't know, benevolently being ruled over or whatever, and yeah, this guy is now rehabilitated enough that he can be back, put back on the farm, or put back into whatever it is that humans are allowed to do as they're ruled over by their alien overlords.
Well, yeah, maybe it's their way of conditioning us, because, you know, we're a really rebellious, independent, xenophobic species, but after this conditioning process, then we become loyal, obedient drones.
Drones.
And we're able to be released.
We can join the swarms.
I don't know why, but yeah, I like your unpleasant ending too. But that doesn't mean
of course I came up with the unpleasant ending.
Well, yeah.
Gino's like, yeah, of course we won the war. What?
See, Big lives in the real world, guys.
There's a plane.
Where men and women don't have sexual intercourse. But regardless of whichever ending you pick.
You were saying Big lives in the real world where men and women don't have sex. If you want
to
re-say
did say
that,
yes.
Or you can just skip it.
Truer words have never been spoken. But regardless of whichever ending you choose, yeah, I think there's promise in that. I think you could write that as a very satisfying or very horrifying story. I don't know. There's something scary about the insect shape. You know what I mean? About just the idea of insectoid aliens. We would never open our hearts to them. You know what I mean? We would never. It's like, oh, they say they come in peace, you know, and they have all these cures for cancer and diabetes and erectile dysfunction. But look at them. I say blow them up. What do you say? You know, that kind of...
Yeah, I think it's just because it's so different from our own. You know, like most animals, large animals, we should say, anything like above the size of insects, they're four limbs, you know, a body and a head. You know, mammals, even reptiles, except for snakes, pretty much everything follows this similar pattern. You know, we all came from the same branch, but insects, no, they're a totally different branch. I guess
fish are a different fish.
Yeah, I was gonna say maybe it's just mammals up where it's all that way, because fish are not that way.
Birds are probably not that way.
Birds do have four limbs.
I've never looked at a bird, but
they've got wings plus legs.
Okay.
So birds, I think, count. Reptiles aside from snakes, are there other reptiles that don't have limbs? Or have different numbers of limbs? It's not like six-legged lizards or something, right? I don't know. Anyways.
Maybe in New Zealand, but the rest of the world.
Anyways, it's, you know, you have the basic shape that everything seems to follow, and then there's insects. And there are any number of effing things. Although, I think
insects always have six.
Arachnids are different. Like, what about a millipede or a centipede or those things? Do those count
those
as insects?
Those are like arthropods or something like that. But they're not insects now.
Okay, so they're not. They're like arachnids, that spiders have eight legs instead of six.
They do. And as do scorpions.
Scorpions and crabs.
Your ex-girlfriend. Those are crustaceans, but yeah.
I think they're still in the. Well, like, I don't know. I am not a scientist, as many of our listeners are, who probably just go freaking nuts when I start spouting BS like this, where they're just like, oh, come on, and they're like saying stuff to the radio as though... I've heard of somebody that listens to podcasts where they would actually pretend they were on the podcast, so people would say stuff, and they would like be driving in their car listening to it, and then they'd say something, and then they'd pause it. And then they'd be like, yeah, no, actually, it's this, and this, and blah, 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 blah. And then they'd play again. And then they'd never come to the pause it again.
If any of you guys do that with our show, let us know. That's kind of interesting to me.
I think it's rad. I would feel too self-conscious to do something like that. Although, I shouldn't. There's something about recording myself that makes me no longer feel self-conscious about it. Like, I can sit in my car and work out a story in my head, but I can't work it out loud unless I'm recording it. If I'm not recording it, then I can't make myself sit there and talk it out.
Because what if somebody saw you or what?
I have no idea. I know that there's no recording, so if I stop talking or I just wander off subject or, you know, give up, then it doesn't matter. I don't know what it is, but yeah, I just can't do it unless it's recording. And I almost never even listen to the recordings again, but I have to be making one or else, I can't do it, which is silly because there's no difference. But yeah, that's just the way it is. There's a self-consciousness to it if I'm not recording, but not if I am. How did we get onto this topic?
I don't know, because I was talking about insects being scary or there's something about just like the legs and like a bee or even a butterfly's head with the multi-faceted eyes and
the
way it turns and the proboscis and things like that.
And it's the just segmented body with all that weird stuff, and like the way beetles are with their exoskeleton thing that the insects have, and all that kind of stuff is just so, it's weird sometimes to think about. You know, when you're a writer, especially a sci-fi writer, you're always coming up with ideas that involve aliens of some sort or another, and you have to come up with, okay, here's a new alien species. I don't want this bice to be the same as the last bice that I did. And you don't want to be like, oh yeah, okay, we'll just be like Star Trek and we'll give them like kind of a bumpy ridge where their nose should be, and that will make them alien. So you try and come up with something interesting, something completely different. These people are like amoebas, and these are like jellyfish, and you know, you look at when you actually stop and do that and like look at the bajillion different forms that life takes just here, you know, it all evolved just here on this one planet. What in the heck might another planet actually be like?
I don't think we can
just
conceive exactly, right?
You know? Yeah, I mean, it's
there are things on our world where you look at them and you go, there's wrongness to it, or there's an asymmetry, or there's just, you know, an alienness, for lack of a better word. So, yeah, what would it be like if, you know, something grew up in a totally different atmosphere with different building blocks and DNA and a different origin and...
Yeah, different stimuli to make it evolve into a different type of a thing. Yeah, and there are some pretty crazy things that I read in sci-fi books. You know, writers really go all out trying to come up with this stuff. They don't just, you know, give them a ridge on their nose and call it good. And yet still, I'm sure they're a million miles from what it's really like, which is interesting. And yeah, it seems like insects are really often aliens. In sci-fi, insect-like things are aliens really often. And then, of course, there is the thousands of species that just look like lizards of one sort or another. Which is cool. I don't know why, but a lizard makes a great alien, too. But it's like a humanoid kind of an alien, if you know what I'm saying. You know, you got a guy with two arms and two legs and then a lizard face. You know, and that's just enough. You've got Bosk, or you've got...
The Gorn on Star Trek.
Yeah, the Gorn, or the Sleestak, or whatever. You know, there's so many of those kind of aliens. The guys from Enemy Mine. She's...
What is it? What was it?
Zombies.
Zombies 145. Okay, I think we're almost done, right? Maybe should we be done?
I believe there is one more douchebag. I mean, listener, that sent us a take. This guy's got a weird name, Rish. It says Rish Outfield. Oh, this is yours. Oh, I shouldn't have called you a douchebag. I didn't realize.
Okay, no, just let me guess.
That's a little awkward. All right. Is this policeman?
Hey there.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good. What are you guys up to?
We are hanging out and recording
a story.
Yeah. Recording a podcast.
Over here in this parking lot?
Yeah, it's a quiet parking lot. There's
a podcast for what?
It's got a short story.
Yeah, we do like a podcast about short stories and stuff like that.
Okay. Alrighty. It's a little weird.
It's getting late.
Alrighty.
We're almost done. That was interesting. That's a first. We recorded in this parking lot an awful lot of times and never attracted the police.
Is it bad what we're doing?
No, I think he was just... making sure we weren't dealing drugs or something like that, I'm guessing.
Yeah, he was nice. I didn't even look at him. All I could see was that super bright light. Yeah. What did he look like?
Bald. Like all police officers. And somewhat chubby.
Okay.
Probably had himself some donuts. Seemed like a good guy.
He was. Well, he didn't shoot me.
Yeah. Which most people would in that situation.
I was trying to get the story open so I could show him. And it's like, hey, there is a part that you could do, sir.
And oh, yeah.
You know how weird that would be if I asked him to do that?
Yeah, can you
but
read
of course
this?
I was a little bit nervous.
Can you read this line for us here, actually?
I did crap my pants.
Can you help me, doctor? Okay, so this one's called Things That Aren't There by one Rish Outfield. So here it goes. I brought Weston into the psychiatrist's office with me. Relieved, he'd at least kept calm in the waiting room. But as the hefty, mannish secretary escorted us in, the boy started looking all around, his eyes widening. Uh-oh. The doctor was seated at a big mahogany desk, with a chair that had to be A, an antique from at least 100 years back, and B, incredibly uncomfortable.
Good afternoon,
he said, half rising. Thanks for seeing us, doctor, I said, tossing a worried glance at Weston, who stood by the window, a worried glance on his own face.
No problem. Take a seat, or you may lie down, if you like.
There was a reclining chair and a more traditional wooden one by the desk. Both looked preferable to the psychiatrists. A gasp. At that moment, the boy saw what he was afraid he'd see. "There's nothing there," I told him. But it was too late. He began to wail and cringe back from the bee, or bees, he apparently saw. The boy regressed in age to infancy as he did battle with an invisible swarm. "It's my son, obviously," I began. Not sure if I should apologize, though I certainly had enough practice.
"Your son?"
the doctor asked. But he could barely be heard over Weston's shrieks. "Yes, I'm sorry." There it was. "He has these fits. Imagines he sees bees. They freak him out. I tell him there's no bees, but he sees them all the same."
"You don't see any bees,"
said the doctor. Only barely a question. I sighed. "As far as I know, he's never even been stung. He just goes into hysterics. I'm afraid mental illness runs in my family. I told your receptionist, my grandfather was convinced that the Japs, or the Japanese, were out to get him, with their bayonets and tan uniforms. And this was decades after the war." Weston calmed a little, stopping his flailing at least. "That's better," I said. "See, buddy, there's nothing there. Just focus on that."
"Does that help?"
asked the doctor. "Not really," I admitted. "He's really stuck in his delusion."
"Right.
Can you help, doctor?"
"I'm not sure."
This time he did stand up.
"You see, you came into my office alone."
Bop bop boink?
What? What is bop bop boink?
Bap zing. It's one of those cartoon sound effects when, and then he looks at the camera and goes, "Womp womp womp."
I wonder if that was worth going to jail for, folks.
So there was the contribution from Senor Rish Outfield. It was interesting. It was nice of you to type up a whole story that goes with that thing. The unreliable narrator thing is always a fun thing to play with. I think one of my first stories that I ever completed... did we use that? I think we used that as an incentive episode way, way back in the early days. Was called The Voices.
No, we never used The Voices.
Yeah, I think we used...
I recorded it for you.
Yeah, I think we used that recording. It. I would just send it to people who donated and say,
"Oh,
thanks."
Is that true?
Yeah, I think so.
The one where I did the British accent.
But yeah, it was that whole...
It was from Hoboken, it turned out, at the end.
Unreliable narrator thing, which is always a fun thing to do. It makes for a good story, I think. I guess you can go all the way back to the... probably further back than this, but the really early on example of this that I think of is the Telltale Heart from Edgar Allan Poe.
Dissemble no more.
Okay, hey, it looks like there's still one more, right? There's one that just slipped in under the wire. I think it just hit the email, like, right now, didn't it? Like, 5 seconds ago?
I think technically it was weeks and weeks ago. I think there's the wire. Okay. Do you see the wire? And here's where the ball fell. So it's several meters past the wire. But
oh, yeah,
if you
want to
call it under the wire, I guess we've seen referees make worse choices.
Yeah, that's true. That is definitely true.
This is this came to us from listener Jeffrey Hoyt.
Oh, I'm not going to do that joke again. You know, this is the second time we're recording this. Again, second time.
Yeah.
Last time I made a bad joke, and we're just going to let that slide.
Well,
maybe I'll include it in the outtakes.
So the show is better because of redoing it. Jeffrey Hoyt sent us this suggestion. A strange man keeps walking past a child's home and opening up a jar with a bee in it, or throwing the bottle, or whatever. The kid is not terrified of bees and strangers.
Okay.
Let's get a judge's ruling on that. The kid is not terrified of bees and strangers. Turns out the kid has a weird disorder. and needs to be stung by a bee every 6 months to prevent it from getting worse. The parents can't bring themselves to intentionally get their kid stung, so they hire other people to do it for them. Yes, I'm twisted.
Interesting. Okay. Now, how could this kid not be terrified of strangers and bees?
Yeah, it seems
if one
like
just
if he...
randomly comes by.
I don't know, because it seems like, okay, if you're not naturally afraid of those two things, right. The first time this happens, maybe the second time, you start to be afraid of strangers and bees. He's like, oh, hey, here comes another guy. It looks like he's holding something glass in his hands. I'll just keep playing. Yeah.
No big whoop.
This is a twisted idea.
Yeah.
Because the thing that's appealing to me about the idea is the idea of approaching somebody. They said stranger, okay? It's a stranger. You approach a stranger and say, hey, you don't know me, but I'd give you $20 to take this bottle. It's got some angry bees in it. And either release the angry bees onto my son, or just throw the bottle hard enough that it shatters at the feet of my son. His name's Adam. He's just right down there playing in the yard. And then just walk away. You, sir, you don't want to get stung by the bees, but it's important that he does. What do you say?
Sure. $20, you say? Well, I'm in.
Hell, I'll do it for $5.
Well, I'll give you $20 for that kind of an opportunity.
That's the part that really jumps out at me. It's funny. Just the idea of a guy, he walks by and he's like, excuse me, is your name Adam? Yes. Smash. And then the guy runs. And yeah, the parents never explain it to the child.
The kid just doesn't know. It just happens to him every 6 months, and he's just like, what the hell, not again. Oh man, well, at least I'm not afraid of bees or strangers, so it's okay. I like it.
Well, and part of me wonders if it would do any good to explain to the kid that, hey, this has to happen every 6 months, otherwise, I don't know, Your buttocks will fall off. So, because you explain to a child, you know, it's like telling a kid he has to get a shot, otherwise he's going to get the mumps or the measles or what, something like that. Usually it doesn't help to explain to a kid. I mean, you have kids who won't take bubble gum flavored cough medicine. You know, it tastes like candy. It's mostly candy, with a little bit of medicine at the very bottom of the bottle. And yet they won't take it. No, ew. It's like it, but it's can't. It's mostly, it rots your teeth. It's so sugar filled and you still won't drink it.
Yeah. I don't know. It is. I mean, that happens a lot, but, I mean, I don't know. There are kids who are diabetic. I mean, I'm diabetic now. That's something that came up within the last 6 months. And so you have to jab yourself with a pin every... I mean, you have to do it several times a day just to see what the chemical makeup of your blood is and what the sugar levels are at. And, I mean, there are kids that come up with this diabetes stuff and, you know, I mean, they call type 1 diabetes juvenile diabetes because that's generally when you find out that you have it is when you're still a juvenile. So, you know, I mean, they get used to it, jabbing themselves with a needle, which getting stung by a bee can't be hugely worse than sticking your finger over and over again. I'm sure it doesn't hurt as bad as getting stung by a bee, but... It's been, you know, it's weird. It's been such a long time that I've been stung by a bee. I can't even recall. I mean, I know it's not pleasurable, but I don't remember at all really how bad it was.
Well, I think part of the awfulness of it is not the pain, but just the fact that a bug did this to you, that there's a living thing. Like we used to catch water snakes all the time. where I grew up. And they'd bite you and it didn't hurt. But when you'd see its head rear up and then its mouth go on your finger or your arm or whatever, you had an instinctive, visceral, reaction, despite the fact that it didn't hurt that much. Because you're right. Seeing it, you know? And I think the bee thing, I don't know, maybe a kid could become numb to it, inured to it. But it seems more likely that this child would become like your son and just have a huge fear of bees all the time. And yes, right. And strangers and mason jars.
Yeah, probably.
I only one way to find out. Where is that?
Yeah,
boy?
let's test it out. We probably ought to end the show and we'll go see if we can get ourselves a bee.
That's a great idea. Deal.
Okay. All right.
So again, this has been sort of a chore this time because we're doing it over again. But the first time I thought it was pretty pleasurable. We went for a long time.
And we weren't even pulled over by the police for doing it the first time around. So a little more successful that time. We weren't arrested. We didn't have that thing happen to us in the holding cell.
I kind of liked that part.
Wow.
But anyhow, it was sort of an experiment. You know, it's like, hey, we're going to give a premise, and if you guys have a take on that premise, send it in. And people did. And that was neat. That was cool. We have another episode, basically fan-driven, except for that last story, because, you know, people had different ways to go with that same premise. That's what the broken mirror stories were like. And when we did those contests, yeah, there were stories that won and there were stories that didn't win, but there were never two stories that were the same, you know, two people that had the exact same take on the premise. It was always just like, oh, wow, this guy wrote a scary story and this guy wrote a funny story and this guy, I don't really know what his story was. And then, you know, this one was romantic, and it was all with the same starting place. And so just the same thing with this, you know, it's like they took Big's idea, and, you know, you can run it in a totally different direction. Somebody, and I don't know if we covered it today, thought that they could write a whole series of, like, children's or YA novels about, you know, based on this premise. Not that they're going to, but they could. And that's kind of an amazing thing, too.
Yeah, I thought this was really successful because of the participation. You know, I didn't expect us to be doing an actual follow-up episode, especially not as the next episode. I figured, you know, if we got anything at all, it would be down the line, and we'd have had, you know, three or four episodes. I guess we don't do episodes very quickly, so maybe that's why. But when they all started rolling in, you called me. I was at work, and you're like, oh my gosh, yeah, somebody sent this, and somebody else sent this, and this is amazing. The, you know, I guess sometimes that happens. You know, we sit here in a car by ourselves just talking into microphones. It's not an interactive thing for us because, you know, we can't see you on the other side of the microphone listening to what we say and then things that you think and so forth that happen because of the show. Very often, you know, we don't get a feel for that very often unless there's somehow something that you have a reason to respond back to us with. And so every now and then when we do something like that and we get a response, it's like, oh, wow, yeah, there are people on the other end of the line. That's cool. I guess that's a really good reason for doing contests is just to get that interaction with the fans because of the show, not because I posted something on Facebook and some people talked about it or something like that, but because of the show, you know, you guys are all interacting with us. It's an awesome thing. It's one of the really, you know, the coolest things about putting a podcast out there. It's like going to the canyon and yelling real loud and waiting for that echo. Maybe you chose the wrong canyon or something and it's not one of those that'll echo back and so you never get it back. But in our case, we get the echo back and it's like, oh yeah, this was worth it. I don't know. It was worth yelling into the canyon so that I could hear my echo. It's not a perfect metaphor, but I'm standing by it.
Well, we hope you guys enjoyed this episode and are glad that we recorded it again. The next episode will be a more traditional one, you know, with the story and us gabbing on a little too long after. So it has something in common with this one. But let us know if you wouldn't mind hearing shows like this in the future, where it's like, okay, here's my idea, and the idea is given, and then people are free to send in their takes on the idea. If it worked for you guys as much as it worked for us, then yes, I think we'll end up doing it again. The retake notwithstanding, it was a fairly easy episode to put out there.
Yeah, and it was fun. It makes me think of that episode of That Gets My Goat that we did on the way back from the New Media Expo, where we just took an idea and we batted it around for like an hour or more, just trying to come up with some kind of a story using it. And this was a similar thing, but kind of a group batting around. What about this? What about that? Cool. I don't know if that counts as a contest, if you guys appreciate that, or if you're just like, oh, that was cheating. All that was just ideas thrown out there and not really stories. I'm pissed at you.
Well, but that's all right. You can be pissed. But that's two more episodes than we otherwise would have had, so.
But yeah, I thought it was cool. Sometimes ideas are just as fun, and sometimes they're even better than stories, because sometimes you come up with an idea. There's so many movies out there where you're like, wow, that's a great idea. Oh my gosh, I can't wait to see that. And then you see it and you're like, well, that was a great idea, but they sure didn't do a good job with it. So, you know, sometimes ideas have more power than the stories that come from them in the end. So I love just to hear people tell ideas. I started buying comic book trade paperbacks because Rish Outfield would, we would drive to work together every day, and he would be like, okay, this is what's happening in this Marvel comic book, and they do this, and this happens, and that happens, and oh my gosh, this idea. And it sounded to me like him basically, you know, giving like a story premise. And so then I was like, oh geez, I need to go read that story now. And so I'd go and buy the trade so that I could read the whole thing. So yeah, I guess I've got a lot of history of the whole throwing out ideas and listening to it and just how fun that is. I think it's awesome. So I wouldn't be surprised if this happens again. I don't know if we can count it as a contest, but it's a fun exercise anyways. And everybody is welcome.
Maybe we will do one as a contest again in the future, but in this way, everybody who participates gets to participate.
Yeah.
And so, you know, there's that. If you made it through to the end of the episode, you are a winner of this almost contest.
Yeah, the fact that we made it through to the end of the episode makes us winners of the contest, so that's good. All right, everybody, thanks for listening. I've been Big Anklevich.
And I've been Rish Outfield, and bees...
excellent to each other.
Okay, that's not bad. Oh, wait. That is bad. That's really bad. Good night.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Parsec-nominated Dunesteef team. No! The Dunesteef is released under a Creative Commons Attribution, Non-Commercial, No Derivatives license, meaning share it with everyone, but don't sell it or change it. Take two.
Doodly-doo, doodly-doo.
The hell?
Should I read Andy Dillbeck's?
Sure. Not the bees! Eat it! No, I didn't want to eat it. You eat it.
Speaking of insects, like a swarm of bugs came flying through the car here in the last short while as we spoke of how scary insects were. One of them landed on the dashboard, and I made Rish eat it. If you listen to the outtakes, you'll get to hear him scream as I force it down his gullet.
What? No, announcer man, cut that part out.
Yeah, and it had legs. Not just the character of the cricket, but just the idea of Jiminy Cricket. I mean, they use that guy for everything. Like, I saw a Mickey and the Beanstalk.
Okay.
It was on Netflix the other day, and I was like, oh, cool. I'll show this to my kids.
Yes, but Mickey and the Beanstalk was made during World War II, dude.
Right. It's an ancient story, but it was a great story. I loved it.
See, but I thought you were saying, yeah, they use it even today. Mickey and the Beanstalk.
No, yeah.
1946 is Mickey and the Beanstalk. What?
So Mickey and the Beanstalk came out in whenever it was during World War II. And when they did it, they had... What was the guy's name? It was like a ventriloquist guy who had his famous...
Edgar Bergen.
Who had Charlie McCarthy was his dummy. And I think he had a couple of them. Like, one was like the dopey one and one was not.
Mentally challenged in place of dummy and dopey.
Just sorry. But that whole thing has just gone away to the point where they made an episode of Buffy where the bad guy... is a come-to-life dummy, ventriloquist dummy that... Because these things are now super scary. They're like clowns, you know, where back in those days, clowns were like happy, fun things you see at the circus, and now everybody shits their pants when they see a clown.
Especially your son.
Because they're scary, and nobody likes clowns anymore. And so, yeah, years later, they thought, oh, we need to pull back out Mickey and the Beanstalk. And so this version... that they had on Netflix is not the one with Edgar Bergen and Charlie McCarthy and all that. Instead, it's got Ludwig von Drake narrating the story. And, oh shit, this makes no sense at all. Because there's a cricket character, but it's not... Jiminy Cricket. So my entire story needs to be an outtake.
It's not Jiminy Cricket?
It's not. It's some little cricket that has some... can't even remember what its name was. But yeah, they replaced him.
For some reason... Cricket. F Ludwig von Drake and F you.
Jiminy Cricket didn't have legs at all. They just didn't use him ever again. I thought I told this story the last time we recorded it.
You did, but you said it was Jiminy Cricket, and I believed you.
It wasn't. It was some little cricket named, like, Sergio. I don't know. Il Grillo Parlante was his name.
If I found out that, you know, like in the mid-60s, the Walt Disney Corporation retired the character of Ludwig von Drake for the same reason that they, retired, like, Little Black Sambo. I would be just thrilled because I effing hate Ludwig.
Really? You know, when I was a young man and DuckTales came out, I thought they'd just taken Ludwig von Drake and turned him into Uncle Scrooge.
Oh, you bastard. You thought Uncle Scrooge was made up for DuckTales?
Well, no. I knew that he came from the Disney's Mickey's Christmas Carol. But I thought that they had used Ludwig von Drake as... Scrooge, because you know they used Goofy was Jacob Marley and Mickey was
Bob Cratchit,
etc. on down the line. So why would they create an entirely new character for Scrooge? I assumed that that's who that was for some reason, and then later I realized no, that's completely wrong. Because if that was the case, then why the hell was he speaking Scottish instead of German? That makes no sense at all. So that's another thing that I was totally wrong about, just like this damn Jiminy Cricket story. I can't believe I told all of that, and it was wrong.
Now would be a good time for announcer man to say, the Parsec Award-nominated Dunesteef, folks.
Oh, man. Is that thing still recording?
I hope not.
It's like Community?
That's what I was trying not to say. But yes, it's like Community. The more you watch it, the more jokes you'll get and more the writing becomes...
funny that Community would come up because that show died, what, 2 years ago? I mean, how long has it been since that last episode aired?
I don't know that it's been 2 years.
Has it only been like a year and a half or like a year? I don't know. It just seems like it's been gone for a while. And yet today I was talking with somebody about it. The first time in I don't know how long, and then again tonight, it comes up again. I was exactly saying that exact same thing. Well, you know what I really liked about you? I brought up the song that at the very first episode, the dean is trying to make his announcement over the, he's got his like microphone plugged into the boombox, and he goes to try and turn it on. And the song, I'm as high as hell and you about to get shot. I'm as high as hell and you about to get... He's like, turn that off. That song keeps coming up in little small places all through the series. When Leonard is doing his reviews on YouTube of pizzas, he does his review, and then at the end where, like, all the little disclaimer stuff comes up, it goes, I'm as high as hell and you about to get shot. And then, again, in the final season, they have their Prohibition episode, and when they're doing the montage about how they are, Frankie Dart, I think was her name, what a terrible last name. Anyway, she was, like, chased away or something like that, or she decided she wasn't going to fight against them. And so they could drink all they want, and they're all having total... I'm as high as hell. You about to get shot. And just, I don't know, just one of those things that I loved about that. And I said that exact thing today to somebody else at work. Yeah, one thing I loved about that show is how it rewarded you for watching continuously. Because they would do little things like that, like bring this completely offhand, and I'm sure they just... made that song up just for that little tiny bit. And, you know, that's all there was. Just, I'm as high as hell and you're about to get shot. Was the entirety of the song. But they still kept bringing it up here again and again. And sadly, I got that song stuck in my head.
Is it your ringtone?
At work. I was thinking of changing it to that.
I know you too well.
But, yeah, I had it stuck in my head for the rest of the day, and I was talking about how, you know, you get a song stuck in your head that you don't know very well, and you keep singing, like, the same line over and over again. Pretty soon somebody's like, oh, gosh, I sure wish you knew the rest of that song because I'm so tired of you singing that same line. Except for with this song, there is no rest of the song. So you can't say that to somebody when they're going, I'm as high as hell, and you about to get shot. Over and over and over again, like I've been doing on this podcast.
Like you've been doing in the outtake from this podcast.
Okay, so back to the beat, y'all. I'm as high as hell, and you're about to get shot. I'm as high as hell, and you're about to get shot. I'm as high as hell, and you're about to get shot. The police and the couple they touch my cock. I'm as high as hell, and you're about to get shot. I'm as high as hell, and you're about to get shot. I'm as high.
All right, take two, ladies and gentlemen. You want to just continue where you left off?
Some bitch.
Search your feelings. You know it to be true.
No, that's not true. That's impossible.
You can destroy the Emperor. It is your destiny. Join me, and together we can end this destructive conflict and bring order to the galaxy.
All right, let's give it a shot.